If you're just tuning in, you're listening to The Amy Jo Show. My next guest is Dr. Farah Gray. He was raised in the impoverished side of South Chicago, and yet he defied the odds and became a self-made millionaire by the age of 14. And let me repeat, at the age of 14. At the ripe old age of 21, he became Dr. Farah Gray, receiving an honorary doctorate degree of humane letters from Allen University in recognition of his ingenious economic mind and distinguished commitment to the development of values. Good afternoon, Dr. Farah. It's so nice to have you back, Dr. Farah Gray.
It's very exciting. I see you all the time.
I know.
I'd rather be listening to you on the radio or seeing you at various events.
Yes, and it's a pleasure because I kept ribbing you, and I was like, Farah, so when are you coming back on the show? And you're like, Amy Jo, I'm coming. I'm just like, no, you're not. No, you're not. You're way too busy for me.
Never. Well, how's the song go? I'm never too busy for you.
Uh-oh. I like that. I don't know. Why don't I co-host something?
Sounds good.
You're so busy. I mean, you do AOL, finance, and a lot of things.
Yeah, I try to sleep in between all my jobs, but, you know, I'm very honored to be a part of so many great things, you know, the ones that are near and dear to my heart being the National Coalition for the Homeless. Mm. When I found out that the average age of a homeless person was 9.5 years old, I said there must be something I can do.
Now, wait a minute. Is this just in Vegas or is
this
nationwide?
No, this is nationwide. This is truly an epidemic that we face in this country. And then being the spokesman for the National Marrow Donor Program as well. Mm-hmm. So those are the things that are near and dear, and being on the board of the Greek Ray Leukemia Foundation. So really getting out and kind of bringing about a change, you know, because in this city, I think that since we don't have snow, we don't kind of, I always use the analogy, I say individual tiny snowflakes are meaningless, but when they come together, they then become powerful. So I think that if we come together, we can really get rid of some of the things that have plagued our country and really build and launch the next generation of the world's solutions.
Yeah, and that's what I try to get across to people when they say, am I my brother's keeper? Yes, we are, because the things that affect everyone else ultimately affect us as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, for my listeners who are not aware of a wonderful young man that you are, let's go all the way back, back into time, and talk about how you started. Because I think it's a phenomenal story. And most people who are in their 40s, 50s, and 60s have not managed to do what you've done far before your 20s. So let's talk about growing up on the south side of Chicago.
Well, it was an interesting experience, and I think that everybody has to have a pivotal moment. And my pivotal moment for me in growing up on the south side of Chicago, I had to realize after my mother had a heart attack that, wait a minute, I have to do something to change my life mm-hmm. and my family's life for the better. So, of course, you know, a lot of people are familiar with the fact that my first business was painting rocks and going door to door and telling people that they were paperweights and bookends and door stoppers. And, you know, and the whole progression process from that to starting my first business club, which we talked about mm-hmm. when I was on the show before, and then ultimately having a food company and a venture capital fund, and both ended up being million-dollar companies. But mm-hmm. I always like to deal with the process. You know, I always say everybody right. wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. Everybody wants success, but not everybody is willing to do what it takes to get there.
And to pay that price, right?
Exactly. You have to pay a price, and mm-hmm. I think you have to be hungry. And I also believe that comfort is the enemy of achievement. When people get comfortable with their jobs, with their lives, they don't want to move. So we really have to move beyond our comfort zone. And I always say that if you're living here on earth and you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much room.
Well, let's break it down just a little bit, because this is very amazing that you became a millionaire before you were 20. At what age did you become a millionaire?
14.
Okay, because I told someone earlier it was 6, but 14.
No.
Yeah,
no.
I was like, wow, he must have sold a lot of rocks.
Not those kind of rocks.
That is so funny. But let's talk about that process even at that age of 14. Most kids are out playing basketball and football and, you know, chasing the neighbors down the street, maybe getting interested in girls. How did you do that?
Well, I think the first thing that we have to look at, I had a reporter from NBC ask me, you know how reporters talk, you know.
Yes.
You know, Far Gray, can you tell me, how is it that you, geniuses and prodigies, you know, all from the projects, how'd you do it? And I kind of looked at the reporter and I said, you know, I think the biggest misconception about black youth is that we like brain power. Mm-hmm. We don't like brain power. Mm-hmm. We like resources, as you well know.
Very so.
We don't have rich uncles and rich aunts in the black community. We don't have people living as trickle-down wealth. We do have some rich family members, but they don't talk to us no more. They've gotten all highfalutin, and how does Madea say it? Herler. So they got all bourgeois Francois on us, eating their chitlins with a toothpick with their pinky kicked up in the air. So we wanted entrepreneurship, but we needed it, because according to statistics, I'm supposed either to be in prison or dead.
Yes.
Not here with you.
You fall into a frame of statistics that
absolutely
say you should be in prison, or someone should have already shot you by now, or stabbed you, or whatever.
Exactly. So for me, making my first million at 14, you know, I believe much of what I've accomplished is common sense. We just have to now turn common sense into common practice. And I think that's the key. When we look at the fact that I started a food company, and I did it based on finding my area of excellence, you know, what did God put us here to do? I think that's the question. So in being able to always cook, my grandmother used to make our syrup for us, because it was a luxury in our household to afford syrup.
Me too.
You know about that.
Okay.
So I got a book called From Kitchen to Market. So that taught me, and then I used the relationships that I had already had from my business club, that I continued to grow the company. I grew it into a million-dollar venture capital fund headquartered on Wall Street. A lot of people say, how? By introducing myself to people. You know,
okay, so let's kind of take it slow right here. By introducing yourself to people, that sounds very simplistic. And it's like, oh, hi, my name's Bob, my name's Roberta, and it's as easy as that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I think that our biggest challenge is that we don't walk up to people. We don't. I've always said that your networking skills has a lot to do with your net worth. So it's important to get out there and be visible. Most people say, you know, you have to be at the right place at the right time.
Very true.
Which I disagree with. I say you have to be everywhere all the time, letting people know that you exist.
So is this why you and I see each other everywhere we go? Because
everywhere. This is why. So it's really about showing up. You know, one of the things that I talk about in my new book is the fact that a lot of people believe in luck. I always said there is no such thing as luck. Most people say, you know, that you have to be lucky to win the lottery. Well, in some respects, you could say that. But even a person who won the lottery, they still showed up. You can't get a hit if you don't take a swing. So I think it's about showing up and having, as Abraham Lincoln said, hustle. Yes, there'll be things that will come to those who wait, but only what's left by those who hustle.
All right, here we go. We are on a roll here. We have a caller. Tracy, you're live on the Amy Joe Show.
Hey, I think it's good evening, I guess, out there. I'm calling from North Carolina. How you doing, Amy?
We're doing just
doing
fine.
Good. Amy, I was just calling your guest, Mr. Gray. I kind of know him, but I don't know him. But I'm I wanted to show up today, as he says, and introduce myself. I'm a professional speaker, I was supposed to have spoke on a panel with you about 2 years ago at George Frazier's conference. I don't know if you remember that. Do you?
Do you remember George Frazier's
conference? Yes, he is an amazing man. We've actually, him and I have been to a couple cities together, And truly, he's quite a speaker. And